this segment sponsored by the SANS Institute, the most trusted source for computer security training, certification, and research. Visit them on the web at sans.org to learn more. And by Tenable Network Security, the creators of Nessus, the world's best vulnerability scanner. Jumpstart your security program today and evaluate Security Center CV, the continuous monitoring solution at tenable.com. And finally, brought to you by Black Hills Information Security, the leaders in penetration testing and active defense. Email consulting at blackhillsinfosec.com to request a quote today.
Welcome back, everyone. This is our stories of the week. We've got a couple of announcements before we go there. Submit your B-Sides Tampa. Call for paper CFP. There's a link in the show notes to four-night cruise conferences, a full 2 days at sea with a stop in Cozumel, Mexico. I always say New Mexico. Yeah. Cozumel, Mexico. Accept the talks to receive a free cabin for two. Larry's teaching SANS 617 Wireless Ethical Hacking and Defense coming up in Las Vegas September 14th through the 19th and the Pentest Hackfest in November in Washington, D.C. and lots more places, so be certain to check out the SANS website for more course offerings.
Yep, and Paul, if you don't mind, real quick, I meant to do it weeks ago because it was happening. I think John may be in the same boat, but in Guardians, we're in desperate need of some very talented folks to come work for us. So
yeah,
if you're a kick-ass pen tester and you can write really, really well, and you
could have a job.
You, in fact, could have a job.
At probably four different companies.
Exactly.
You get your pick. It's what we're talking about
exactly.
Before the show.
Yeah.
So if you do...
Yep. Larry@guardians.com or hit me on Twitter and find me on Facebook, you name it, and get me a resume. I mean, that's the big thing. We do require a little bit of travel.
What level pen tester are you guys hiring at?
We hire seniors.
Okay. And yep. Now, John, you've got open positions for kind of like low and medium, I guess you could call it. I don't know how you describe it, but
we have that pretty much locked down. We're down to just seniors as well.
Oh, okay. And, I saw Mike had posted on a list. I thought it was the other positions, but no.
Yeah.
And I think that Larry and I need to get into a kind of a sexy sort of plea for senior pen testers, right? You know, like how can we do this seductively? So if you're a senior pen tester, I just want to say that we love you, baby.
Yeah.
This is the place.
Is there like a signing bonus? Because now they got a pick between.
Well, we heard that we can pay you 50 cents and.
Yeah.
So, you know, not every pen testing company is going to love you the way that we love you.
So John's offering up love as his signing bonus.
And I tell you what, at the end of the day, at a conference like DEF CON or B-Sides, your feet hurt. And as the owner of Black Hills Information Security, I'll give you foot massages.
Love and foot massages. Wow. Larry, you going to up the ante?
Yes. Yes, I will. Yes, I will. I will, great. In fact. At one of those conferences, your feet may hurt. And... as one of the owners of InGuardians, I can, in fact, get Jay Beal to take you out dancing.
Oh, dancing with Jay Beal. That's pretty attractive,
then
John. He's a good dancer.
Get John Strand to rub your feet.
He's trumping your foot rubbing. He's saying that he has control over your magical hands, which...
He does.
Don't ask me how I know that they're magical. Wow.
If you come to work at Black Hills Information Security, you will have the opportunity to actually work with real females.
Whoa.
Wow.
Do either of you have drone strike protection? Because
no,
apparently that's something is... Now, I know you're in South Dakota, John, so I don't know if there's Wi-Fi in the mine, but that, you know... You might be able to hide out in like Bin Laden hiding out in the mountains doing your hacking to prevent from drone strikes.
I think John's the only one with that.
I think you should use that, John.
Senior pen testers out there, right now, Black Hills Information Security, courting senior penetration testers, is the only penetration testing company that owns a mine that's 275 feet deep. That's deep, and it drifts in three different locations, a quarter mile underneath the ground, about 150 feet. That's drone strike protection, my friends.
That's awesome.
And we also do drone strikes, too, but I think I'm pretty sure that Guardians can do that too. So.
Yeah, probably. Yeah.
Yeah, we just don't talk about it.
Commodity skill. But there was a hacker that was doing this was involved in recruiting for ISIS, but used his hacking skills as part of the recruitment for ISIS. Yep. So the headlines read that a hacker was drone striked, but it was really part of terrorism.
Yeah. He was a recruiter for a terrorist organization.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
Now you can't Cryptia has made the point that he got killed for being a recruiter, not for being a hacker.
Mm-hmm.
Rob Graham has made the point that you can't completely separate the two.
Right.
I have... Yeah, never mind. Yep. This isn't a political podcast. We're not going there.
Yeah.
Yep.
But drone strikes. Mines.
Bad.
Drone strikes.
So John, I want to throw this back at you. And I think this is the case. And... We're hiring seniors, and you guys are hiring seniors.
Well, Jack's a senior. Oh, senior pen tester.
Senior pen tester, yes.
He's got his AARP card and everything.
But don't be afraid to throw your resume into the ring.
Someday, too.
Yes.
When you're hiring seniors,
you
is
are
like,
lucky.
Is AARP the same
and
thing
you're
as...
you're pushing your luck.
It's when you're a senior, is AARP the same thing as a CISSP? Is that like a qualification?
He's a reluctant AARP.
CISSPAARP. Yeah. CISBARP. That should be a bundle.
Certification bundle. Yeah.
I got friends on the board. I should bring that up. That should be a bundle. The CISSPAARP bundle. How much money could we save at Holiday Inn Express, right?
you get a discount for renewing your membership
the Denny's
early.
Denny's Happy Hour seniors meals, right? With all of the oyster cracker packets you can steal.
And it starts at 3 p.m. for the dinner special.
That's right.
Yep. Yep. Pen test starts at 4 a.m. right about the time you get up. So back in a serious
note. Yeah, nothing gets up at 4 a.m. anymore. I mean,
yeah, so John, back on a serious note, my suggestion would be, you may not have senior in your title now, but you know, bits are cheap. Throw your resume into the ring, and quite honestly, you might surprise yourself.
In all honesty, I've got to say this. If you're out there and you're looking for a pen testing career, I recommend staying away from pen test puppy mills. You'll as I like to call them, the pen test puppy mill industrial complex. You'll know who they are. Yes. And Guardian is not part of the pen test puppy mill. Far. Trusted Sync is not part of the pen test puppy mill. Secure Ideas is not part of the pen test puppy mill, and neither is Counterhack Challenges. Choose your company wisely.
I would also add that BHIS is not also part of the pen test puppy mill.
Thank you so much. So,
I think you should submit your resume to all five of those companies and just
fight. No,
if you're a qualified senior pen tester,
we're not that far away from that, to be honest with you.
Speaking of the skills gap, organizations, corporations are having the same problem with this. And one article suggests multiple things for corporations to do that. One is outsourcing staff. One is pushing work to other teams, using automated technologies, and upskill existing staff, which I think that's the long road. Hire from other sectors, it's kind of interesting. Run or attend competitions. That may be a good thing to do for the five companies that we mentioned, was to hold a competition.
That's pretty cool. We do that with our interns.
Like a hacking challenge.
And stuff, yeah. But I like that. That's a good one.
It is. I think that's the only one there that really has any merit. Trying to build security skills into your existing staff is not...
Unless they're interested, then...
Some people will say security is not going to be a standalone job that's just going to be baked into everything else. I still think, to this day, after 10 years of doing the show and hearing people say that it is a niche kind of skill, and there's a certain mindset that's associated with it that I think is really important, that I think this article is kind of missing out on. And I think you can hire that out, certainly. I mean, certainly we're talking about pen test companies, but you can hire some of those security skills out. Managed security service providers might be a different story from penetration testing, so be careful when you hire out. I get asked a lot, what should I look for in a managed security provider? It can be
a contract that's easy to get out of.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm not saying there aren't good ones out there, but I'm just saying it would be a good idea to have a contract that's easy to get out of. You can take that as you will. And I think a lot of value in the operationalization of security, right? The more integrated security is in your processes, the better. But to your point, there are, if you're listening to this podcast, you've had this conversation. It's like, I can make it do this. And you get a response, which is, but why would you do that? Oh, okay. Right.
And so that's
where that mindset comes in of, look what I did. Right.
John.
I was just going to say, that's it. We're going to start up the Security Weekly Managed Security Service Provider. We charge half the money and we don't do shit, but at least we don't lie to our customers.
Holy shit. That's
wow. Brilliant. All right, John, what were you saying about pissing all those people off?
Yeah.
we didn't call out anybody specifically.
What I always tell people is if you can prove that a managed security service provider...
None of us have ever burned bridges like Chris Nickerson. Because that dude is a pyrotechnic master. That's all I'm saying.
But I don't know. Was he talking about Dell SecureWorks at some point in the past? I don't know. I must have missed something.
If you can get a managed security provider to take care of your operational low-hanging fruit when it comes to security and have a fair degree of confidence that they're going to do that for you, I think that it's a value add. I would then
I was acting laughing at the requirements.
Oh. I would then kind of allow your internal team to focus on more of the deeper stuff, as Jack was saying, deeper operational stuff, internals of your network. But I think there's certainly value to, especially if you can help define the low-hanging fruit for them and have them take care of the, operational things, the things happen every day. I get all the alerts from my antivirus system. Yeah, these systems need to go get cleaned up, I know when I see these events that XYZ needs to go happen. You know what? Absolve me from that process. When you find ABC, go do XYZ. And if you can use that as a way to free up your own time to do the more interesting and in-depth stuff that goes along with security, evaluating new products coming in, improving processes, looking at developing the next security solution that will help protect your company, and have your managed security provider help you with that operational stuff you're dealing with today. Yep. That's where I think they fit in very well.
Yep. No.
Now, some cases very well, some cases depending on the provider, not so much.
Right.
The key is finding the good ones.
And I will argue that on the converse of that I think a lot of people think the MSSP is a panacea.
Yeah.
It's a one,
like, oh, it's, I have an MSP. Like, I'm secure. This is great. I can go on vacation.
I can go on vacation, or I don't need to look at the next best thing because they're doing all that.
Mm-hmm.
And or my security program is complete, and I have somebody looking at that.
Mm. No.
No.
Wrong approach.
No.
Well, good. I'm glad we had that
discussion. And I also think you should test them. Like, you do vulnerability assessments and vulnerability management. You should be testing your MSSP every single month. I mean, just for grins, you should start scans on the outside. Do they detect it? Just for grins, you should start up malware command and control and have it leave your environment. Do they detect it? And just try that a little bit.
Not only do they need to detect it, they need to report it to you if that's within your
report SLA. Report it in the right manner. Yeah. And do they contact the right people and does it get done? I mean, that's almost like an internal pen test you should be doing all the time. You know, testing your own operations. Mm-hmm. It's a great point, John.
Carlos, any comments?
No, the only comment I can say is that all of this has been said and done so many times. Everybody knows what they need to do to get stuff secure, and we still see people not patching their shit, not looking at their logs. But you know what?
I'm going to disagree with you, Carlos, a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to disagree on the fact that I'm starting to see people finally starting to patch their shit. I think that people are getting better about that. I do. I don't see as many criticals whenever I'm doing external assessments. I'm not getting in using Metasploit exploits as much as I used to. But I will say this, while they're getting better at that, configuration issues like default passwords on things, administrative interfaces being exposed, having direct indexable directories with all kinds of sensitive data. I'm seeing a lot more of that all the time.
But John,
how about logs? How about actually looking at their logs for stuff?
That doesn't look like $250, right, Jack?
So many times I've talked with friends that are pen testers, and they're telling me, I schedule a task. I left it running. I go like, and they didn't see the log. And they, no, dude, they don't do log forwarding. They don't use Splunk. They don't use nothing. I did a bunch of stuff. We then went back. Everything was in the event log. The thing is that they were not looking at it.
Once again, I don't really blame customers for that. I blame the logging industry. And the reason why I kind of blame them for that is because if you look at your SIM provider, right, you're going to go out and you're going to buy something like ArcSight. You're going to buy Splunk. They keep on having this theory. It's like, just log everything and let your SIM figure it out. And that is a failed approach. It doesn't work. And the reason why it's continuously being forced down the throats of all these companies is because all these different SIM providers, they're basically trying to sell and scale their product by the number of logs that they ingest. And they raise the price up. So they're constantly pushing people to log more, log more, log more, log more, log more. And everything becomes white static and white noise. So I don't blame companies so much because they're constantly going out and trying to buy a solution, but the solutions and the vendors out there are actually actively lying to them, and they're doing it specifically because they can try to drive more money to their products. And that's my rant.
I would defer a bit there from the term that I'm in a couple of mail lists and chat rooms where a lot of people are from blue teams, and the discussion 90-something percent of the time is not about logs or how do I detect stuff or even how do I understand my systems better. Almost 90 something percent of it is WSUS, tell me about DiskKB. Oh, DiskKB broke this, DiskKB broke that. Oh, how did you deploy this patch? Almost 90 something percent is talking about patches, and then all of a sudden I send an email to the list about, hey, there's this new cool attack, but if you enable this auditing and you can look at the logs, it could be easily parsed. You can actually run scripts to kind of detect most of the most common techniques on hosts, and I get complete silence, and then they keep going back to, oh, that you saw that this patch broke this patch broke that. And the way I see it is a lot, we've turned a lot of security teams into patch teams. Patching should not be one of the responsibilities of the security teams.
That should be operationalized. And unfortunately, that in the past couple of years, specifically with Microsoft, the security focus had moved forward, I think, but has really fallen back to patching. And that's not exclusively, but largely on Microsoft. The quality of the patching is not what it should be. And more importantly, the quality of support for patching is not what it should be. And so the people with limited cycles, to defend what frustrates me and Carlos, because I know exactly what you mean, what frustrates me is that folks with limited cycles are forced to become patch managers when they're trying to be security people. And it absolutely should be operationalized. You know, in our world, Paul, in vulnerability management, what do we see? We see people who use their patch management platform and call it vulnerability management because they, never mind, right?
You know, they manage their vulnerabilities.
And it's bad enough. And when it's WSUS, so they don't even get flash.
Well, and that was my
John mentioned, configuration management's super important. And we have so many solutions. And the thing is that many times, yeah, you can have Chef. You can install Chef. You can install Puppet. You can install desired state configuration. All of those three are free. You have Ansible. You have the tools. But many times when you look at the teams that are supposed to manage all of that stuff, they don't even have the basic knowledge on administrations. And it's that lack of basics. It's that lack of motivation. And I don't blame them for not having the basics. I don't blame the actual admin. I don't blame the actual user. What I'm blaming is the structure that they have to operate under, where the way they are measured by management, it's how fast can you patch my boxes? What is my uptime in my boxes? Because the way you measure somebody at their work will define how they will behave and what will their priorities be.
Well, and unfortunately, to kind of add on that, Carlos, a lot of those metrics are being driven by managers who, whenever they were actually in the trenches doing IT, that was the most important and most difficult thing.
That's a good point. It becomes
this really sad parable with what we're doing successfully today, or maybe not successfully, but better today, is what we had trouble with 5, 6, 7 years ago. And a lot of that has to do with the management kind of lag, because they're still trying to fight the same problems that they were fighting when they were in the trenches.
Well, and if you look at today in modern Microsoft operating systems, the vulnerabilities, specifically if you look at Metasploit vulnerabilities, even vulnerabilities as a whole from the modern operating systems, are almost all client-side vulnerabilities.
Yep.
Remotely exploitable vulnerabilities for modern Windows 64-bit, to even narrow it down a little further, are like few and far between. Do the research. If you contradict me, please let me know. But I'm telling you, from what I've seen, modern 64-bit Windows operating systems.
Here's the opportunity. If you think Paul's wrong, please mail in.
go back from this year back to 2013. I'm telling you. For the modern systems, all of the exploits are on the client side. And from what John was saying,
I'm putting up with Windows 10 and all of the privacy bullshit that I've gone and unchecked stuff, and the fact that, Jesus, by 2017, this OS will be ready for prime time. What a steaming pile of shit it is.
That's why it's free.
But I'm running it because that's what the world is running. More people are running Windows 10 now than OS X.
Yep.
It's actually got a...
Is that true? Really? More people running Windows 10 than OS X?
Yeah. Yep, that is true now.
In less than one month, 75 million...
Yeah, it's not ready for prime time. Just try to get it to handle multiple monitors consistently. You can sort it out, and about the fourth reboot, it'll be like, I have no idea what these extra monitors are for. Try to get it to get like screen power off the screen and stuff. Yeah, the third reboot usually works. Today I made a change. It worked on the first reboot. I was psyched.
But the security stuff of it is awesome.
Security is fixed because calc.exe is the new store app. It's not the old calc.exe. Yeah. So that broke everything. I mean, you can type in calc.exe and you get the crappy store app.
I want to go back to John's point that, you know, when he does pen tests now, a lot of people are getting better at patching when he does remote assessments. But John, what about your phishing expeditions? Are you seeing them increase or decrease in success, or are they staying the same?
I'd have to say that companies are getting a little bit better about that, but I think that a lot of that has to do with the fact, this is something I've talked about quite a bit, and Larry, I'd like to get your impression on this as well. The customers that I've noticed that we tend to get, that are listeners to Security Weekly, a lot of them have come up through SANS training. They're just better. They don't ask really, really stupid questions as far as the pen test, and they tend to be far more prepared. That doesn't mean that we don't get in. It just means that they seem to be doing better. Like,
do they educate their users better? And does that impact your phishing? Because when I do the analysis, it looks like client-side exploits are still today the way that the bad guys are getting in, still today the way that pen testers are getting in.
But what I am noticing is that your user population is still going to have roughly 30 to 40%. They're going to click anything. Mm-hmm. You can send them a link that says, do not open this. It'll compromise your computer. And they're going to click it.
Mm-hmm.
That's going to happen. But what I am seeing organizations get better at is reacting to that. As soon as they see something weird on the network, they react faster. Users that get the link but don't click it are far more likely to forward it on to the help desk and say, what the hell is this?
Mm-hmm.
And they tend to react a lot faster. But yeah, you still see user populations that it's about 30%. They're going to click just anything that comes across their desk.
Yeah.
The organizations are getting better. So I'll pass it over to Larry to see what he thinks is his population is about the same as ours.
Yeah, John, and I'd say I think you're right, though. Those folks that are doing that, that they're well better prepared. They do education, but I still think you're right. Somewhere between the 20 and 40% of all of our phishing campaigns are successful, and you'll still have those users that will click stuff even though we're told not to.
Yep.
We've actually been in done a couple recently where we send all of the pretext to the customer contacts that have asked for it beforehand. Here's a couple samples. We'd prefer to use this one because we know it's a really good test. But here's a couple of other things based on what we've been able to determine about your company and pretexts. And we've had a couple of them come back and say, every one of these is too good. Our users are not that smart. You need to have some tells. Like, and then even still, with tells like misspellings and links that direct to places where they don't really go, mm-hmm. and you know, bad grammar,
and then at the end of the day, you end up sending the FedEx ruse, and you're like, God damn, this one again, oh, because they're like,
the FedEx ruse works.
The FedEx ruse. You have a package that was undeliverable. Please click this tracking number to find its current status. You know, you can come up with the most awesome ruse, and then if you give them 5, if you give them 50, and that's one of them, they're like, oh, that one looks safe. Let's go with that one. Because clearly that doesn't work.
I do have to say, I have seen some new generations, new companies out there of users that don't have all of this old management baggage of how do they measure people and what they're doing. I've actually seen some pretty nice security teams where here comes the pen tester, they do their job, and then at the end they go like, I want a presentation at the end of the pen test. I want mm-hmm. you to come in. I want you to do the presentation, which is actually rare. Not many people actually ask for the presentation
yep.
at the end. We want the presentation, and then we want you to sit down with us and help us identify what was the spore that was left in our network. And I mention it because for some reason, all of these guys are ex-military, and they always use it kind of like the same terms. And something, I actually asked them, why do you use the word spore? And I said, oh, it comes from tracking. When we're out in the field and we're tracking people, and what they leave behind, we call it spore. And I'm like, oh, that's cool. And they're actually leveraging the tools that come with the OS, and they're actually very, on the second or third pen test, they kind of nailed most of the tactics used by the attackers. And you need to come up with new ideas. It's no longer, oh, let me just put automation. As soon as I get the shell, I'm going to run all this stuff. You go like, uh-uh. As soon as I get that shell, I'm staying there quietly, just waiting to see if the shell dies or not. Didn't die after 5 minutes. Okay. Let me see what they're running on the host. You check what they're doing. And then you start moving more carefully. It's actually making pen testers better, not automating so much and being more noisy. And I'm actually seeing kind of like a new gen of security teams out there. They're actually wanting to learn, actually wanting to do their jobs better, are a lot more disciplined. For some reason, most of them tend to be ex-military. I think even though all of the wars that we have messed up a couple of generations, at the same time, they're putting out their a new breed of people who are very disciplined, that like generating SOPs, starting operating procedures, and they're going like, okay, you did this, you got in, okay, let me examine, let me modify all of my stuff, let me fix it. Next time you come in, we should be better. You come in next time, now it's 20, 30% harder, and they go like, okay, how can we tight this even better? We'll call you in 6 months, we'll call you in 9 months. And they keep improving. I'm actually seeing that with a couple of new companies out there.
Speaking of user awareness, I wanted to talk about the Ashley Madison password database that someone cracked.
Yep.
Did you guys read this article?
They didn't crack all of it. But
no, but if you read down in the comments, the most interesting part of the article is in the comments. Because someone in the comments said, well, I added some stuff, such as checking that the username is the same as the password. And I cracked
19,664.
Yeah, so a lot more passwords just by simply adding the logic of, is the username the same as the password? And some other logic he added.
And I saw
too.
Some other ones from the John the Ripper mailing list today that they were able to crack basically 3.7% of the passwords using the top 4 passwords.
Right.
So come to my talk at DerbyCon. I'll be talking about exactly this.
Nice.
Not necessarily Ashley Madison, right. But
I thought it was very, very interesting. Anytime we have that data, we pretty much seem to conclude the same thing, and that is that people use pretty crappy
passwords.
Yep. The other interesting thing is the person who cracked the 19,000 passwords implemented the bcrypt function in Python himself or herself. I don't know who it was, but yeah.
And maybe, if that person is interested...
I was going to say, if that person's interested in being a senior penetration tester, there are some people you can contact that would probably be very interested in hiring you.
So I know that we touched on it very briefly, but I kind of want to come back to it. The Ira Winkler article on, on how there's not a shortage of cybersecurity talent or we're just looking in the wrong places.
Yeah, I was going to bring us back to that, John. Yeah, I thought this was interesting. I don't think I necessarily agree.
I was going to say, does Ira kind of shoot for a 50-50 percentage on good articles versus absolute crap? It must have been a crap day when he wrote this.
I haven't read this one, but this is a point that Michael Santarcangelo and I don't know about this, but the idea that we have a shortage of talent is, do you know that 115 years ago there was a shortage of groomsmen to handle all of the horses in major metropolitan cities around the world? And the solution was not more groomsmen to handle the horses. It was cars and get rid of shit technology.
Pun intended.
Literally shit technology. So we have an immediate, there is no denying that there's an immediate need, but at the risk of ranting, a huge part of the immediate need is in AppSec and web AppSec.
Get rid of shit technology.
Where there are companies that cry that they need web AppSec people, and they try to hire developers and offer them half of what they can. So let me get this straight. I'm paraphrasing a conversation I've had more than once. Developer interested in security wants to cross into security. So they're having a conversation with fill-in-the-blank AppSec company, large or small. Let me get this straight. I've been writing code for 5 years, and you're offering me half what I make. So let me get this right. I can make twice as much writing shit code as I can trying to fix other people's shit code. Fuck you. I will continue to be a mediocre developer. And so that tells me that there's a lack of demand at a viable price. And there's part of the problem. And people won't pay. And I haven't had this conversation in like 3 weeks. We'll pay you half. We'll pay you actually less than half of what you're making to write mediocre code. And the code you write is great, but the company just wants mediocre, right? We'll pay you less than half to do web AppSec, or you can continue to be a developer. So there's part of it. But, you know, to your immediate need, there are a lot of people that have immediate needs, but this is not a simple thing. And now that I've teed you all up, go ahead, John.
I want to go back to your horse analogy in that technology solved the problem. In a certain respect, we have the potential
change the problem. New problems.
Change the problem in our security industry that sometimes, and more often than not, compounds the problem.
Flash. Because of the just use Flash.
Well, because of the economics. I mean, you look at any device or new technology, it just breeds more security vulnerabilities that we all have to fix, and that's part of the reason why we are where we are now. But the innovations that I see coming out like way down the line and stuff that's being developed now is using technology to help solve some of those security problems. But that is like such a minute, small piece of the technology coming out today. There's way bigger technology coming out.
We've wound up John good and tight now. Let him go.
I'm going to throw a hand grenade out because I think Jack is wrong. And I want to explain why. In the web developer example, I've had the same conversation with other people.
Oh no!
But I don't think that actually speaks to the problem. So let's talk about technologies that actually move security forward, that actually do a really good job. Let's talk about carbon black. Let's talk about bromium. Let's talk about Bit9. These are all technologies that are the equivalent of getting rid of carriages and computer security and replacing them with cars. But they're leaky. They make tremendous ruckus. They break down all the time, and they're very hard to implement. And it's actually going to take more people to actually implement many of these technologies and implement them effectively. And the reason why... sounds like the Model A.
Right,
but the problem with it is, whenever you're looking at an organization, they're not just buying 1,000 Model A's What they're actually doing is they're buying a Model A that's tuned for this, they're buying a Model A that's tuned for that, and one that's tuned for that, and actually tune these products appropriately takes a tremendous amount of dedication and it takes a lot of work. So I believe in some cases, when you're talking pen testing, I'm going to be one of the first people to say the world probably doesn't need 400% more pen testers. I just don't think it does. But I do believe that the world does need probably about 200% more in the way of on-the-line security people going through and baselining, configuring, locking down configurations, and doing the right things in computer security. So that's my point, so I'll throw the mic back at you guys.
Well, don't forget, we're just not dealing with technology. In security, we're dealing with people who are behind keyboards, but who keep adapting, and then we have to
Since Michael's
adapt
not here,
as soon as
I have to,
figure
I have to
something
ask this,
out.
Does the expense, does the cost of doing this justify the results? Are we making so much more money through this shit technology that, insecure or not, we're coming out ahead?
Right. Well, in most cases, yeah, we're making more money.
Yeah,
it's better to ignore the problem and deal with it.
But that's
is it all going to come to fruition? I mean, Bruce Schneier always talks about how in certain areas like IoT, it's all going to come to fruition and really bad things are going to happen. And another article that I read talked about the how fires in Chicago, the Great Fire, everyone's like, well, we need to have smoke detectors and fire departments to check for them and formalize and pumps and formalize the fire response. And it wasn't until the second big fire in Chicago that all of that stuff actually got.
So there are all sorts of metaphors.
Rob Graham that said that.
Argued with me a little bit about this in Vegas, but initial stuff. So like auto safety, I hate that because having spent all those years in. But like one of the things, like we do all this and cars cost $10,000 more than they need to now because of fucking airbags and shit, right? You have an 18-mile-an-hour collision, you throw your car away because of the cost of it. What actually is saving more lives by early data? Because it's a long game for automotive safety. Those scalloped edges on the shoulders that say, hey, dumbass, get back in your lane. And as much as I hate them when I'm on a bike or something nimble,
Like a Segway?
Yeah, right. The reflective dots in between the lanes.
Or as they call them in Vegas, the drunk dots.
Drunk dots, yes. They go da-da-da-da-da. Those sort of things are really making a difference, right? They're like, hey, get back in your lane. Wake up, dumbass. You know,
stop
those sort
texting.
Of, right? And so there's...
Sober up!
There's, you know, there are interesting technologies that can help, and those are the... you know, but it's too early. We don't know if that's it. We don't know if it's like the center high-mounted stoplight. I don't know if you guys, if you're my age and you're in car business, you remember when they put the third stoplight in, the high one.
Yep.
And for the first couple of years, holy shit, you couldn't avoid that thing, right? Because it was different.
Mm-hmm.
And now they're invisible to all of us. They're as invisible as everything else around us, and you get used to it. So,
so they need to have one that, that changes randomly.
Yeah.
All the time.
Yeah.
Or put one of those lead signs in the back of your car, and every time you step on the brakes, it shouts like, fuck you!
Yeah.
What? Just put a sticker on your car that says baby on board. Everybody drives nice. They don't flip
then,
you
and,
off.
And then you stick a doll on a board put on the bumper.
It was a Gallagher, right? Yeah. That was a Gallagher
Jack,
thing.
Jack, I got a historical question for you on automobiles. What were automobile accidents like whenever the automobile first started taking off? Were they just like rampant everywhere? I mean,
they were rampant everywhere, but they were extremely low speed. There weren't a lot of cars, so they ran into different things. It took years for them to start really ramping up fatalities. But you know, so it's there are all sorts of corollaries with all sorts of things, right? New technology. People start playing with it, bad shit happens, but then, you know, the car thing, you start adding more power because people want to go faster, then bad things start happening. Mm. And, I mean, you can go back into the 70s, and it's only been in the past decade, I would argue, that pickup trucks, people that love big vehicles don't understand they don't have to meet the same crash standards, so a 4-star, 5-star vehicle that's light truck category, you know, they're bringing them different, but something that's big is different. And it hasn't been that long since it was very common for pickup truck style vehicles to have the unpleasant habit of sending the steering column through the roof of the vehicle. Because they had solid steel frames, which made people feel safe, and they had that big steering box out front, and they had this big straight column that was attached to the steering wheel. So big, massive tank vehicles. And you get in an accident at high enough speed, it would shear the bolts on the steering box, and the steering column would leave the car through the roof. The problem was...
Your head was in the way.
There was a steering wheel that separated your head from your torso on the path out, right? So the
Jack Daniel, now accident-free since 1910.
Well, now as long as we're not talking about that. Bladder control. I mean... so... We could learn from other people's mistakes. That, Jack? No, John, we could learn from other people's mistakes, but when have we ever done that as a species?
How much of what we're doing in computer security doesn't actually help? And I think that that's a really good question. Well, and
that's it. And there's this split that some of the more academic papers I've read recently, which are not new papers, have pointed out this challenge. And the challenge is right now you need to help your clients be more secure. Right now, I need to help my customers be more secure. Right now, we need to help people, you know, people listening need to secure their system. And that means applying bandages. And a lot of the bandages we apply are going to be obsolete in 3, 4, 7, 8, 10 years. And all of the resources put into creating bandages are useless in a decade. But we have to do it. But it distracts from fundamental security. And then you get into, you know, people who think we should have stuck with BBN's 10X and continued to refine that until it was truly secure. But yeah, I couldn't run that on my iPad. And
Have any of you seen the Chaos Communication Camp? I have not been to
camp.
That happens right after DEF CON, right?
Right.
There was like a Hackers on a Plane thing that would take you to all of them. Well, one of the talks was about satellite hacking, mm-hmm. and your badge was the same electronics that you needed to intercept.
Not your badge, but there was a separate badge that was sponsored by a group, the radio badge.
Yep. Yep.
And that was
RAD-10 badge. Yep. 4,500 of them were given out and can intercept the Iridium communications network. Does anyone know the largest consumer of the Iridium?
The radio is a clone and modification, but with similar capabilities of the Hacker F1.
Right. Okay.
It was based on the open source Hacker F1.
Do you know who the biggest consumer of the Iridium communications network satellite network
US
is?
U.S. government.
That would be Pentagon. The U.S. military.
Yeah, Pentagon.
Yeah, because they're remote communications.
Yep. So I thought that was pretty cool.
Anywhere on the planet.
So you can get the details of that on the internet, in case you're interested. I think it'd be pretty fun. Or use your Hacker F to do it. Yep. All right. Well, that was that story.
Okay.
Did you read Iron Geek's article on TSA master key duplication?
Yes.
It was fun to watch it unfold on Twitter, though.
What happened on Twitter? I didn't see it unfold on Twitter.
He was shooting all kinds of tweets to the manufacturers of the locks saying, hey, how would I get this type of lock? How would I get this core? How would I do this?
I'm going to ask my locksmith to make a duplicate of this key. What blank do I tell him to use?
Yeah. And then one of the companies actually responded and said, due to security concerns, we do not give out the blanks or we do not give out the information on the core.
Due to TSA's control of the security of these.
Yeah. So it was very interesting. It was almost like, well, we know what Iron Geek's up to this week. And then finally, whenever we saw the blog post, it was awesome.
Yeah. I mean, well, they're all not that hard to pick. They're not that hard to pick.
I wonder who at TSA got fired over this.
Yeah,
I don't know that it's that much faster to have an actual key than to have a pick.
Right.
I mean,
not only a pick, but when you look at where all these locks are being used, they're used in luggage. Luggage typically have zippers. You only need a ball pen.
Pen, yep.
But this is, I think, the gist of this, and I think the thing we need to take from this actually ties with the car analogy that, you know, Jack was talking about a little while earlier. We do all of these things for the sake of computer security, and they don't mean shit. And this is one of those things, you know, we'll look back years from now and be like, why in the hell were they doing that? That doesn't actually stop anything. You can cut it with wire cutters. You can cut it with a side snips. Or
wait, what do you do with the ballpoint pen? Separate the zipper from the
zipper.
I mean, you know, this is exactly in line with, you know, automobiles. It's like, well, oh shit, we don't know how to make the thing safer. Let's just make them heavier, bigger. That seems to be the right answer.
Yeah. So far, well, heavier and bigger actually worked when I was transporting guns. Pelican briefs with master lock.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
Worked very well at the airport. I never had a problem. They never had to be TSA.
There are places where that makes sense. And in vehicles, there are places that make sense. But I've been, you know, now I'm driving my sad minivan. But, you know, for years I drove small cars.
I mean, told you need to put flames on it.
I should. It was agonizing moving up to something the size of a Jetta wagon, right? And that for me was a huge car because I drove tiny, nimble cars. And there were times that I missed accidents by an inch or two, you know, people spinning out in front of me or whatever with the mount I drive. Like, if I were in anything larger than a CRX SI, I would have been tagged in that, or a Renault LeCar for the old people.
Oh, dear God. Please tell me you didn't own one of those.
I owned a bunch of them. I had a pretty hardcore rally-tuned one. It had a top speed around 107, 108, which was amazing for those.
And that was downhill with you pushing.
that was great. I had fun with those.
That car's back in your day had the floor cut out, Jack, so you could move your feet.
Isn't that awesome cars?
Yabba dabba doo!
Those are awesome cars. Someday I'll have a fun car again. No, actually, I probably won't. Hey, my minivan.
Well, Jack, your car is fun for the whole family.
Yeah, my minivan. Not that I've been driving a lot this summer. 12,000 miles in 10 weeks.
Wow.
It's not a lot.
That's a lot. Most people don't put that on
the best, right? Yeah. Best investment. The sheepskin seat covers from the old dude in Pennsylvania.
Speaking of hackers getting in a van, great article about the loft in the Washington Post.
From June.
Yeah. I don't know why I just saw it today, I would add it because I thought it was interesting. Yeah. We didn't talk about it on the show. But as one of the members of the loft described to me everything that happened, I thought that this article, and there's been lots of articles written about the loft, this article did a really good job of capturing what happened. And some of the stuff that was told to me was like, I don't know if I would ever repeat certain sections of it. Like, this article kind of hinted towards some of the things that went on.
If there are adult beverages and certain members of loft, you get interesting stories.
Yep. And this article was spot on, as far as I could tell. Having some of that information, I can tell you this article was spot on.
It's, you know, every time somebody points out that BGP is insecure, I just...
told you so! Wait, no, like, I didn't tell you but...
If only a bunch of kids had driven to Washington, D.C. and told us this
Before Congress
decades ago.
Yeah, it was interesting. Did you ever watch the video of the testimony? Is that in like archive.org or something? Like, I never thought to go seek out the video of the testimony.
It's on YouTube, I think.
Yeah, it's probably on YouTube at this point, right? I've never watched it, but in the video that they have as part of this article, there are clips from it. It's really funny to see the people that we all know and love, like back then. It's awesome.
Yeah, well, like,
yeah, well, and they've all become domesticated now. It's kind
of
interesting.
Like, look at the main image of the article. It's like the Last Supper right there.
It is.
It's like the Last Supper.
It's only without Mary Magdalene, unless you refer to Mudge as Mary Magdalene because of the hair. But
it's pretty hilarious.
Oh, that's
Brain Oblivion, Tan, Kingpin, Mudge, Weld Pond, Space Rogue, and Stephen Von Neiman.
They told the story where they drove into the NSA.
Yeah, they told that
with a van full of antennas.
The rented van. Yep.
The rented van. Yep.
Yep.
There's some other pictures in there that are pretty cool too, like them standing outside getting ready to go into the to the hearing and stuff.
Now
they look old.
They don't just look old.
Right.
They are.
Jack happens to be an expert in these areas.
I am.
Dude, we're getting there.
Yeah. You know, that's a great point. It's getting to be the pot calling the kettle black.
Oh, look at... Yeah, that's Yeah, I remember when his hair was that dark. I mean,
yeah. I remember when he had bifocals, not trifocals.
Yeah. He's all domesticated and shit now.
Yep.
I actually hung out with a few of those folks not long ago. It's still a good crowd.
They're
still great folks, and they have some great insights, and what they can remember is really cool.
Yeah, from what they can remember.
Because they're old. I get it.
Well, I got to say, most of them look pretty good, but I think they're going for the Keith Richards approach, though. Yeah, some of them.
There's lots of pictures of the original hackerspace.
Kingpin has aged very well.
Gracefully. You know what? I think he looks better than he did back here.
And, you know,
he looks like a kingpin.
Maybe that's where he got the nickname from, Larry.
Yeah, maybe.
Yep. So anyway, no. I don't know.
Anyway, I thought it was an interesting piece. Well, then the whole premise of that article that we're not discussing is how they said, this shit is broken years ago in front of Congress. And here we are today, sitting here on this podcast going, this shit is broken.
It's not just BGP, but that's the easy one to pick on.
Yeah, exactly.
Right? It's not just BGP that they told us about years ago. And many, many, many others. But they're just such a focal point,
mm-hmm.
and it's so easy to point to them. There are a lot of other people
who told us
a lot of other things.
This was like a pivotal history moment because of a lot of things. Because they used their hacker handles, because they were
handles,
the way they looked, they were so young. There's a story behind it.
It's phenomenal hacker history. But
you're right. There's a lot of other people.
There's a lot more. Not to take anything away from this, because this really is, like you said, this is pivotal. If this intrigues you, scratch the surface and find where it leads. Because all the Loft crew will lead you to the people that led them and the people that they led. Mm-hmm. And that's one of the... God, I get my kumbaya moment last week, so I'm not going there. But it's the... I made up for it with the Ashley Madison story. I've explained. So I may have flipped a little bit. It's not just all of that. It's what they started, right? Because Loft became At Stake, which has the At Stake diaspora changed or created much of what it is we do for a living now. And what it didn't directly create, it created the space that we work in many ways.
Yep.
So it's huge and important.
I just want to change gears and hit another story real quick. The Secret Service agent has pled guilty in the Silk Road case for stealing the equivalent of what I want to say was about $500,000 or $600,000 in the equivalent bitcoins during that investigation.
Stupid, and got caught and just pled guilty.
Stupid. So, yeah,
that was stupid.
That was stupid. That was incredibly dumb.
Incredibly dumb.
You can track them. They're not anonymous.
Does it have a unique identifier? Well, yeah, that's how you know it's worth something. So how is it that that's anonymous? If it ever gets attached to anything where you can turn it into anything other than Bitcoin or gets transferred, okay.
Not too smart.
And then if you do dumb stuff and don't even make it hard for people to track, you end up in prison instead of the Secret Service.
Yep.
I'm sure it's cool being in prison as a...
Yikes.
Debadged Fed. I'm sure that works really well for you.
Word spreads fast about that.
That's a former Fed.
Even in the whatever prison he would go to is probably still not a good...
Tennis camp prisons in Connecticut. It's still probably pretty rough.
Still probably pretty rough for him.
Yep.
Speaking of tennis camp prisons in Connecticut, did you see, because I know you've called it, and you may end up in one of these for using them, did you see the Filet firewall?
Ah, yes.
Totally awesome.
Totally. I don't know how I didn't... So, John, remember when we were sitting... I don't know if you were paying attention to my conversation with Nick that we were having at DEF CON over dinner where I said, you know, what will be really friggin' bad is that all these people think, well, my wireless router at home that is also my gateway firewall device It is not hackable because I don't open up the administration port to the internet. And my thinking was, all these devices, or most of them I've seen, have universal plug and play. Mm-hmm. Wouldn't it be awesome if you could launch a massive phishing campaign and get someone to load some code in a browser that uses universal plug and play to then open up the firewall?
It's okay. Here's nobody would be that stupid. Yeah,
something about Mike Poore saying, if you click your heels twice and wish really hard, you'll someone find may. What you dream about on yep. the internet in terms of whatever
and
you're
to,
searching
and
for.
And to read the introduction to the Phileo Firewall. Phileo Firewall vulnerability. An attacker with a specially crafted website may cause a user who's running Chrome or Firefox with JavaScript enabled to make arbitrary UPnP requests to their firewall, thereby opening their network to compromise.
Yes. Now, your router, in the thing they're not telling you in that opening paragraph, is your router does have to be vulnerable to the DNS pinning attacks as well, which okay. is another component to the... Now, most are. Craig Hefner has presented about DNS rebinding, or DNS pinning. Essentially, you get you make the two similar A records, right? You make the first one invalid, and then the second one is actually making a request to the other port, to really explain that really poorly. Mm-hmm. But if you search for DNS pinning or rebinding.
And the one that I'm looking at the video is just a screenshot of the video where they say you need to make it really big so you can read all of it. It's pfSense.
Yeah.
Which, of course, and, you don't know version.
Sammy, it doesn't come enabled by default on pfSense, but Sammy Kamkar also talked about DNS rebinding in part of his attack,
yep.
How I Met Your Girlfriend, that he talked about as well. So that's not a new attack, but certainly putting these things together into the Phileo Firewall is,
I'm going to admit this on the podcast that I actually have UPnP turned on my pfSense firewall. You know why? Because if you want to use your Wii U on the internet with the new online engine so that you can play Splatoon,
you have to enable
in
it.
Multiplayer mode, you have to enable UPnP so that it can talk outbound to the servers.
So I think there's a lot of UPnP enabled routers out there.
Yes.
There are.
I think you're going to see a massive campaign to get people to open this up, because what that does is expose their routers so that people can make a botnet out of them. Right now, your botnet is the largest ones I've seen are about 400,000 or 500,000 nodes. If you were to take this attack, you could triple, double, quadruple, ten times the number.
The reflection attacks. I don't know if we talked about it right after the Akamai report came out some months ago, but you know, it's the last year was the year of UDP. Protocol reflection attacks, NTP and DNS and other things. And some months ago, I don't know if there's one since then, but some months ago, the Akamai State of the Internet report talked about, I think it was SSDP, which is the UPnP discovery protocol, right? Yeah. It's the UPnP.
It's the something something discovery protocol.
Simple. Super secure double penetration.
Yeah, that's it.
or super safe double penetration.
That's right. That's when that's the point of condoms.
I think it is simple something discovery protocol, but whatever. Exposed on a lot of commodity home routers.
Yes.
And it was being used for DNS, I mean, for reflection attacks.
Yep.
And the point that the
simple
thank
service
you,
discovery right. protocol. Thank you, Chris.
I got 3 out of 4. That's pretty good for me.
at your age.
at my age. But the point that they made, and we'll have to see if it holds true, is who runs DNS servers? Well, hopefully people with some knowledge of technology, right? And we so hope. That eventually has largely been brought under control. Who runs NTP servers? Assholes like me who take it seriously, and if we made that mistake, we fixed it.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Who runs SSDP?
Oh.
It's never getting fixed.
Nope.
Never getting fixed. You can ride that pony into the sunset, man. That's just
so I think it'll be some time, but I think my prediction is you're going to see more of this attack.
Yep. Yep, no, I think your prediction was more of this attack
I wish
a long time ago.
Things like
and they saved us a lot of programming time to write it because they wrote it for
this
us.
Is gonna be, do you think this is going to be another Karna style botnet?
Absolutely. Times 10.
Jeez.
Times 10.
And I would say Karna our only salvation is the lack of power of these devices, but the power in tiny little crappy chips is not so tiny, little, it's and not, crappy anymore.
Not anymore. Not right. anymore. These, and not to mention, once someone does compromise your router in this way, who's going to find it? Your AV?
Yeah, it's not going to find right. it. And then once they own your gateway, it shouldn't be that much harder to start owning shit inside.
Yeah.
But that takes extra effort, just owning these commodity devices, you know.
Well, and the interesting thing is they have to know the IP address of your router, which most people leave at the default anyway.
192.168.1.1 or 0.1 or 100.1.
Yep.
Oh, God. I'm having flashbacks to supporting firewalls where people didn't understand why VPNs worked when they tried to connect a whole bunch of devices.
With the same internal network?
With the same internal network. And at least that was more readily solvable than the people. I don't deal with them, but I have had it confirmed in the past couple of weeks that folks in that world still see this all the time, where people make up their own address space because they don't know what RFC 1918 is. And my favorite was in a past life having a customer who had assigned an internal net block, a large chunk of which was taken over by an Akamai expansion.
Oops.
So a third of the internet is inside your network now. I'm sorry, but you're not actually hosting a third of the internet, so that third of the internet no longer exists for you.
That's awesome.
That's awesome. You
or
know,
the other
you
way,
can,
if they start injecting those routes in BGP, they can take over the third of the internet. I've seen that happen. I've seen
the levels of
hardcore networking people can tell you horror
abuse,
stories.
Right. The levels of NAT abuse I've seen, and I will admit to perpetrating, to trying to get people out of the holes they've dug for themselves. I mean, there are times that I just said, get out of the hole. I'm bringing in a backhoe to dig a deeper hole for you. Because that's all we can do now.
Well, Carlos and John, thank you very much for coming on this
week's
episode. It was
awesome having you back, John.
Yes, John, good to see you back. You haven't been here in a while. Carlos, fantastic as always.
And we didn't even get to see any pictures of Carlos.
I know. Well, because there's some kind of ad on the... We got to figure that out. We didn't have time to figure that out.
Not only that, he didn't send any video.
Yeah,
well, he's wearing.
He doesn't have a shirt on.
He's wearing his naked shirt. Oh no, he's naked.
He's hacking naked.
Right.
So, Larry and Jack, thank you very much. Larry,
thank you.
Take us out.
Oh, overhand. How hoot.